There's the Judds. Why not me on Real Country? Well, today is National Margarita Day. It's also National Cook a Sweet Potato Day. And I've got Jake Owen on now with Homemade on Real Country.
Where I grew up, getting dressed up means a button-down shirt and a good pair of jeans. Wasn't Sunday supper without collard greens. Dad was boss. Christ is king. Friday night was living for them lights to come on. Then I turned to Miller Lights when I turned 21. There's some things about me that I can't change. I'll always be the man that George Strait mixtape that was homemade.
Now in Kingston and Rhinebeck at 92.5 FM.
Goodbye. try to sit down, talk to her, it always end up in a fuss. I try to reason with her right up till the time that she got on that Greyhound bus. It'd be better if I could forget her, cause she sure forgot about me. And if it takes all night, I'm gonna do it right. I'm gonna sit here till I can't see. Well, I'm sitting on the bar stool acting like a darn fool. That's what I'm doing today. And I'm sitting here drinking, trying to keep from thinking I'm losing my troubles away. But now I couldn't make her stay. Well, doggone her anyway, she can't say that I didn't try. Pour me another one, I'm finished with the other one. I'm drinking my baby goodbye.
WGHQ, 1260 WBNR. Good morning. You're now listening to Kingston Community Radio, airing on FM 92.5 and AM 920 WGHQ, Kingston, New York. This programming is brought to you by our listeners and corporate underwriters who are interested in presenting local community radio. The opinions expressed on this program do not represent those of PAML Broadcasting or Kingston Community Radio. Listeners are encouraged to send in $10 per month to help bring this program to you and mail your contributions to Kingston Community Radio, Post Office Box 4364, Kingston, New York 12402. For more information or to donate online, visit our website at mykcr.org. Good morning. This is Dan Gatiss, and thank you for tuning in, sharing the morning with us, and being a part of today's program, Monday, February 22nd, 25 degrees here in Uptown Kingston. Snow showers early, becoming steadier snow for the afternoon, 1 to 3 inches today, a high of 34. And at least a quick glance at the cancellations. Saugerties schools are closed today, and so are Kingston City Schools. Yeah, 1 to 3 inches. What do you go figure, huh?
Come on.
All right.
That's a blizzard.
Yeah, right.
Plus,
okay.
It's not starting till later, right?
Huh? They'd be home.
Yeah, well, no, it's starting now. And then tonight, partly cloudy, a low of 26. Tuesday, cloudy skies with a shower of rain or wet snow possible tomorrow. 30% chance of that, and a high of 42. Tuesday night, a few clouds, a low of 28. We'll be right back.
You're listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM. And also online at mykcr.org.
Moms, we don't know how you do it all, but you do. You are part teacher, counselor, chef, and doctor. All rock star. Being a mom today is complicated and sometimes unpredictable. But it's those precious moments that make your journey together crazy and wonderful. At the American Heart Association, we know your family is why. That's why we're here for you, to make sure more of those moments happen. To make sure a healthier, longer life is possible for you and your family. We're impacting laws that help shape healthier communities. But we can't do it without you. Moms are at the heart of change. So here's to you, Mom. Here's to impacting the health of our future. Moms United can make real change. Start by visiting lifeiswhy.org/moms. The American Heart Association and the American Stroke Association. Life. Life is why.
Hi, this is Anne Marie from the great town of Kingston, and I support Kingston Community Radio, and so should you.
You're listening to KCR, Kingston Community Radio, AM 920, 92.5 FM, and streaming online at mykcr.org. KCR is a call-in show, so 331-9255 is your line. And that's 331-9255. And yes, indeed, I took a quick glance at the cancellations, and indeed, most schools are closed as they do go. You know, usually they follow suit with each other. Kingston City Schools is closed, only remote, and Saugerty Central School District is closed, too. And I'll give you some more updates next break. And how you doing, guys?
Good morning. Hi, Dan. Good morning.
How you doing?
Nice to
How
see you.
How you doing, Fran?
You can tell by the tone of my voice, I'm not Lorraine Salmon.
But
can you
tell? You can get the tone of Lorraine there Salmon's voice because she is with us right now.
Okay.
Good morning, Lorraine.
Good morning, Fran. Good morning, Tony.
Good morning, Dan. How are you?
Just ducky. How are you?
Good. All is good. Waiting for another blizzard, I guess. Another
one
to three.
I just heard there's more closings.
Yeah. Isn't that crazy? I mean, mm-hmm. It's like they must think they're in Dallas or something, closing school 1 to 3 inches. Poor Dallas. Poor Texas, right?
Yeah, bad.
Yeah, crazy. So how are you, Lorraine?
I'm fine. Thanks for asking.
Right.
How's everybody there?
You're in the cozy comfort of your chaise lounge, probably, with a...
Not quite.
A morning beverage.
But was going into SUNY Ulster today, so we'll see what's going on there. But it's so far...
When is it supposed to start raining? I mean, snowing, or whatever the heck it's supposed to do.
I thought 1 o'clock.
Raining, snowing, hailing?
Oh, yeah, we'll be open all day.
Yeah, 1 o'clock. Okay, well, all right. So, Lorraine, you're on, and it's great to hear your voice. So you have some big things going on, or 'tis the season to start another President's Citation, yes?
Yes, the President's Challenge.
Oh, Challenge.
So it's this time of year, over the next 2 months, will be our biggest fundraising endeavor that we have all year. And that is to support 50 students, 5 in each middle school across Ulster County, with a 2-year tuition-free scholarship to SUNY Ulster.
That's
first
amazing.
And family to go to college.
Mm. Yeah, that program has been really great since it was started. Can you just explain what it's all about and what the concept is?
Sure. And then you can maybe talk a little about it because you've been really helpful, Tony, in helping us find new sponsors and helping us grow the program. So the idea was born through President Al Roberts when he came up from Florida to be our president here at SUNY Ulster. And he had the concept of us doing exactly that, reaching out to 8th grade students who would be first in family to attend college. And that if we could find students in the 8th grade and have them go through an application process and an interview and eventually receive this award, this scholarship, that being able to be in contact with the students in 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th grade, we thought that we could help, you know, not just help students gear themselves towards college, but actually have them become part of the college before they even leave high school, so that all of those things that would have been uncertain for them would be known. You know, they would already feel like they're part of the community. And that's exactly what's happened.
When did the program start?
The program started 5 years ago with 6 students from Rondout. And
since
Rondout is right next door to SUNY Ulster, we did a pilot program there. We opened it up for 5 students, and within weeks, we had 6 donors.
Jeez.
A donor sponsor a student with a $7,200 sponsorship, and many donors are able to make those contributions over a 4-year period. So it's $1,800 a year over 4 years. And 6 students were awarded the scholarship, and we began working with them and with Rondout. Rondout was key to working their administration, working with us to kind of work out the kinks and find out how this would work. And it's been an amazing process. So 2 of those students have already gone on to a 4-year school.
Oh, wow.
And we had our first student come 2 years ago because she graduated a year early.
Wow.
And we now, let's see, our last, right before COVID, pre-COVID, we had all of the students to the campus, and we had 100 students.
Wow. Yeah, that's great.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I...
150 students.
Jeez, that's an amazing impact. I participated with the Highland Rotary Club in a session down in the library in Highland High School a couple of years back now, I guess. And the look on the parents' faces was just, you know, the kids were like kids, you know, pretty much, fine, cool, you know, but the parents were just beaming, you know, with pride and, you know, you could tell that they understood the value and significance of the program and what it was going to mean to their son or daughter. I mean, it was really amazing. So yeah, it's a great program, and it's kind of an easy sell in terms of, you know, changing, having an immediate impact on somebody's life that they would not otherwise get.
Right. You know? Exactly. And I love the whole tying them in early, yeah, so that it's not, you know, mm-hmm, the unknown or a last-minute thing.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. The first time they come to campus, and when we first came up with it, I didn't know, you know, you never know what's going to come across as cool or not. And we decided the first thing they were going to do is go get badges, their college IDs. And
that's great.
It's one of the most moving experiences of my life.
Yeah.
You know, and I didn't see it coming. And I literally had to kind of corner myself a couple times because I was getting emotional.
Yeah.
But, you know, to see these students come in and, you know, just go up to a security counter and fill out a form and get their photo taken, and moments later out comes a college ID badge that they can either wear around their neck or put in their wallets. And to watch student after student have their picture taken and to see them, you know, acting like students, you know, some of them were teasing each other and laughing as they were getting their photos taken. But after all the kidding was done, you could see the pride in the students. And it was just, it was what you said, Tony. When they first received it, they don't really know what they're, you know, they're just like, what did I get? You know, like, what is this going to mean? But the parents get it. And then
the
when the students
really
come to
it.
Campus, they start to get it.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting. I'm thinking these are 13 and 14 year old kids, really. I mean, right? Eighth
grade.
Is that
how old they are?
I think so.
I guess, yeah.
I think so. Around 13, maybe.
It's been so long, I don't remember.
Depending on where in the year they're born, I guess. But, you know, I'm trying to think of myself back when I was 13 and 14. And I'm trying to, you know, I would say college was probably not top of mind for me. You know, it just wasn't. So I give the parents credit again, because I'm sure it's they that are saying, hey, this is important. And I don't know what the application process is or how that goes, but I'm sure that's pretty interesting as well. You might want to describe that. You know, how is it a competitive process?
Yeah, that comes out in May, and each of the schools rolls it out similarly but a little differently by each school district. But basically, there's a public meeting or a public way to disseminate the applications. And students apply, just like you would for any scholarship, and write an essay. And then we let the next step happen. So this is sponsored by Ulster Community College Foundation, Inc., for SUNY Ulster. But we let the application process occur at the middle schools, because we feel that the guidance counselors and the principals know best their population. And so they take all of the applications and they shortlist to 10 students. And those 10 students get an interview. And at the interview, they're quite often interviewed by the president of SUNY Ulster, Al Roberts, usually one of us, either chief of staff Jen Zell or myself, and almost always Nancy Clark, who's our program administrator. And then one or two people from the high school, so sometimes the superintendent, sometimes the principal, and often a guidance counselor. But think about that. Imagine you in the eighth grade, at the end of eighth grade, being interviewed by a superintendent, a principal, and a college president.
Yeah, that's got to be intimidating at some level, right? I mean,
they do it. I mean, it's just amazing what they step up to.
Yeah, well, good for them. I mean, it's a credit. The other thought I had is, since you mentioned earlier that you had two graduates from college now.
Well, not graduates, went through the program.
Oh, right, because it's 5 years.
Decided to go straight to a four-year.
Gotcha. So it's year one for them since the program started. It must have been the folks right at the beginning.
Yeah, they're at the end of year. Year one was COVID. You know, imagine that.
Right. One of the things that impressed me about the program was the videos that you do or did, which were just so compelling. I remember the parents' faces, mother crying, you know, dad maybe crying too. But I'm curious, it would be interesting if you went back, you know, at some point, if you can go back to the two that have started and interview them again and find out, you know, what this program has meant to them, you know, kind of full circle, then, you know,
sure.
It comes.
Well, we'll definitely be doing that with our student who came a year early.
Right.
She is in her she's completing her second year.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's been wonderful.
Yeah. Because I think it's a big selling point to potential donors that, you know, can see, you know, the impact and hear it from a person that's been through it.
Right, exactly.
Right? A young person that's been through it saying, hey, this definitely changed my life. And mm-hmm. So.
That's so funny. That's our slogan, Tony.
Oh, really?
It definitely changed my life.
Wow.
Because one of the students said that.
Tony's a plant.
Oh, yeah. I'm not a plant. You can water me occasionally, keep me in the sun. That's fine.
Yeah, and so just for anyone who's listening, you know, and wondering about, you know, donors and what that's like, we have donors, well, we have over 70 donors who have sponsored a student. We have, I'm looking at the list now. We have over 10 donors who have sponsored twice, two students.
Wow.
We have 6 donors who have sponsored 3 students. We have somebody who sponsored 4, somebody who sponsored 5. Jeez. And Rich and Donna Croce have sponsored 10 students.
Jeepers.
Wow. That's amazing.
So if someone wants to find out information about how to do this, how to become a sponsor, what's the best way to...
Well, the best way would be just to call me, and
okay.
I'm happy to put my cell phone out there, which is 518-859-5279. That's an old phone number from when I lived up in Albany, but I'm local, Lorraine Salmon, and I have been working at the college for running this program and the foundation for 6 years now.
Great.
Crazy as that might
be. Give it once more, Lorraine,
sure.
Please.
Sure. 518-859-5279.
Okay.
And also, you can go to suniulster.edu and just put President's Challenge in. It'll take you right to our page where you can see the video that Tony spoke about. But also, just to tell any potential donors, no pressure here. If you call, I can send you a link on your phone or your to your email, and you can just pull right up on your phone. Tony, I think you've seen the link.
Yeah.
You can open it up on your phone, and you can see all the other people who have donated and are a part of this program, so you can see if you have a friend or two who are in the program as sponsors. And all the information is there. And then, of course, I'm here, and I'm happy to walk any donor through as much of it as they want.
Great, great. It's a great investment. I have to mention, yesterday I was on the Italian radio show, and we were talking with an author. His name is Mike DeLucia, really a great guy. Just wrote a book about growing up in the Bronx in the, you know, late 60s, early 70s, and, you know, growing up, and I think both of you did, I don't mean to age you lovely, beautiful women, however, before cell phones, before the internet, and how much different the kids today have it, and whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, growing up at a time, so imagine the world without cell phones. Imagine the world, Dan Gatiss, without the internet.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful thing.
See?
It's a beautiful thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's incredible how interactive the world was on paper and by phone and
not to go down
bopping in on people.
It used to be you could just, whether it's Google or let's call it a search, you could search engine something to find out what is the truth, what is it, what is the answer.
So,
and now you have to decipher what's real and what's not.
Yeah.
I'm not talking about political news.
Yeah, yeah, I'm political
talking
news.
Like,
right,
you know,
yeah, no,
whether
that's true.
There's giant sharks out there or not.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's funny because I said it was the end of bar bets, because you would make a bar bet, you know.
Oh.
Now you could just look it up. You can't make a bar bet anymore on something. And so what else did I? So I bought a copy of the guy's book.
Okay.
Mike DeLucia. It's called Being Brothers. I bought it right online during the show. So I said, okay, well, here's an advantage of the internet.
Yeah,
I just bought a copy of your book.
Yeah.
You know,
that's awesome.
And but you know, I think we all kind of decided that, you know, those of us that grew up at a time that there was no internet, were no cell phones. You know, we probably were better off for it at some level, I think, right? Mm-hmm. Playing outside and more creative mind, more, I think, I don't know. It's a debate for the ages, really. Growing up now without the internet and cell phones.
You know, Tony, you have grands and yeah. grandchildren now, and it's just amazing. You know, they're just constantly looking something up or reading online or.
Yeah.
Yeah. In that sense, I think it's good because they can expand. So if you had to give them one, maybe we would have been okay still if we had internet, but maybe not the phone.
Not the cell phone.
Yeah. Well, what would all of these, I think, talk about all of this in COVID, you know? If we told all the children they couldn't go out and play with the neighbors,
what would have happened to us?
Well, that's called the 1918 influenza. I think. I don't know. Well, cell phones had been out. Yes, yeah, so the last one, the H1N1, the swine flu pandemic. I think that, well, that was, cell phones were out by then for sure, 08, 09, and obviously. Cell phones came out, what, in the mid-90s or so-ish?
That one I have a hard time, yes, and I want to say I got one in the mid-90s, but I remember the first fax machine, getting that at Edgewater. And
yeah.
Like, wow.
Big deal.
This is really going to
Now we just, we do the,
yeah.
We do the cross fax. Of Dracula for the fax machines.
Right,
so.
Right. It replaced the mimeograph machine. Yeah, I don't know. So it was a little walk down, because that was the nature of the guy's book, but you know, it's...
It's nice to think back to simpler times where,
well, right.
you know, you just played with right. the neighbor kids because that was the
yeah.
extent of
yeah.
you weren't texting a friend in a whole other
yeah.
area.
Well, Fran, on the business side, I remember when each thing came out, everybody said it would be the death of something else. Like when fax machines came out,
right.
we used to spend a boat ton of money on overnight packages. We were a construction company back then, right?
Yeah.
So it was like you had to get the specs over to the project by the next day. So I remember people going, oh, my gosh, this is going to kill FedEx and UPS. They're done.
You know, yeah, right.
Because everybody had the fax machine and all of those overnight letter packages will
yeah.
go away.
Yeah, that's a very good point. Most all technologies have a swing to it.
Right.
And we're overwhelmed still with the internet. It hasn't swung back to a synthesis, we would say.
Yeah.
Usually you have a thesis, which is like the fax machine is huge and it's going to replace everybody.
Right.
Or
right.
the, you know, or synthesizers in the music world.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
It, you know, oh, yes, it's going to. But then there's this antithesis where actually you have a thing against it for a social
smart.
Period of time, and then a cultural period of time where it's actually synthesized into the culture. And yeah, we're still overwhelmed by the internet, but we're finding a way to synthesize it with our lives and not forget that we're human, physical human beings that need exercise. And
yeah, we just turn into a big brain. So our grandson, we had we did, and Lorraine, I'm sure you can appreciate this. He's now into experiments, you know. So we have baking soda and vinegar and
oh,
and bubbles.
We've done it.
Oh, it's hilarious! And he's, you know, he's got a little lab coat on and his PPE. He's got his little glasses on because it comes in the kit, you know, and food
great.
Color
That's
and
great. How old?
He's a little over four, so he's digging all that stuff, man. He loves all that stuff. And we made soap dinosaurs. that was fun, you know. But you know, so that's. But then, if you give him a phone, he'll be, you know, he'll be like, put yeah. the stinking phone down.
Right. Like I think. A combination of both. Everything
yeah.
in moderation.
Right.
And I was thinking before, like you were saying, but when we were growing up and there weren't cell phones and internet, and it was like more organic. And it's funny that now all of this didn't replace things, but now there's organic searches and organic yeah. social. And like, it's funny how organic then took on a whole nother.
That's true. It's true. You want to talk about our... Or your organic show today?
organic show.
Hey, I'm
going to
do it.
Yeah, what's who's on? Who's on? Who's on for guests?
About synthesizers and how they change things.
Say it again, Lorraine.
Oh, I was going to take a segue from Dan's comment about synthesizers and how they change things, and they thought they'd, you know, wreck certain things, and it ended up being, you know, an amazing part of our music. So the synthesizer was invented by a guy named Alan R. Perlman, and his daughter, Dina, works at the college.
Oh. So
that's why you would know that.
That's why I would know that. Because I'm looking at it now. He founded ARP Instruments, and so some of your most famous musicians that, you know, people idolize him for the creation of the synthesizer that he
created. I remember Peter Frampton was like one of the, that I can remember anyway, one of the first that started, you know, synthesizer, I think. I don't who knows. But that would have been a great, well, I would have to Google that.
Well, that's the other thing I was going to say about you, Tony. You're constantly, when you're talking to people, you are constantly looking up anything that gets spoken about on your phone.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? You're always like ahead of the conversation because you're looking up what everyone's talking about.
Yeah, I was trying to think about, well, how could I do neurosurgery if I wanted to do neurosurgery? Let me Google that.
That's a great idea.
Or let me watch it on YouTube.
DIY neurosurgery.
The four people that invented encyclopedias and popular science and all that, those little books, right?
Uh-huh. That was encyclopedias, right? I was thinking about that.
Ooh. Yeah, bad.
People are much more apt to just Google something than to grab an encyclopedia.
Yeah, forget it, man.
Mm-hmm. But so the publications are very, very authoritative. Like something doesn't pass muster.
Yeah.
Like in Scientific American, unless it's really been checked.
Yeah, research. Yeah. 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 But everything is like an online magazine now, right? Pretty much. There's some hard copy floating around still. Who's our guests?
At 7:30, we should be hearing from David Boyd and Kimberly Brown. They work for Purple PR, and that's the PR company for Salt Properties. And for those that may have seen them already, there are some fun accommodations happening down at Hutton Brickyard that will be opening hopefully in May of 2021.
Great.
There's saunas, there's these cute little cabins, and it's just adorable.
So this is the hospitality training, or no, this is a whole different place. I think it's the same place.
Oh, yes, they are doing the hospitality training.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah.
Which they'll talk about.
It's a whole nother deal. But okay, so that's kind of cool.
Yes.
That's 7:30, and then 8 o'clock is Raleigh Green. I believe he'll be in the studio with us. And then at 8:30, Fran,
At 8:30, we will be talking to Kingston Wire. Let me get her name.
Okay.
Without the internet, I couldn't do this.
Right, exactly. We'd have it written on a piece of paper, God forbid.
Right?
Yeah. All right. Well, we have until 8:30 to figure that one out.
Amberly. See, I knew it wasn't just...
Amberly.
Yeah, Amberly Jane.
Oh, Amberly is her first name.
Amberly is her first name, and that's why I needed to look it up.
Okay.
Amberly Jane Campbell from Kingston Wire.
Great.
At 8:30.
Sounds good. Lorraine, give another quick plug and overview for President's Challenge, please.
Great. So it's the President's Challenge at SUNY Ulster. It is a scholarship program that is awarded to 8th grade students, 5 in each middle school across Ulster County, and that's 10 middle schools, so that's 50 students across Ulster County every year. So we're always looking for donors, and we are on our fundraising campaign right now. We have 11 of our 50 donors that just kicked us off, and we have 12, and we are excited to speak to anybody who's interested. You can go to our website at sunyulster.edu and just type in President's Challenge. It'll take you right to our video and a lot of information. Or you can phone me at my cell phone number, which is 518-859-5279. And I'm Lorraine Salmon, the executive director. And I'm happy to send you a link and talk to you personally.
Great. Okay. Well, thank you very much. Have a great day. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks, guys.
I'm kind of filling in for you, so thank you. But that's okay. Have a great day. And... watch out for the white slippery stuff.
Yeah, I'll be out there soon. Yeah. Okay, yeah. Guys.
Thanks, Lorraine.
All right, take care, Lorraine.
Have a good day.
Good morning. Have a good day.
Take care.
I need to correct myself before we go to a quick break.
Yeah,
because
sure.
David Boyd is possibly the founder and chief executive of Hotels.
Okay. Well, there you go. That's a big deal.
We're going to find out a lot.
Yes, we will. And he might be on the air. I see Dan with the phone, so maybe one of our guests, our 7:30 guests, will call. And Dan, do you want to take it away?
Absolutely. Thank you, Tony, and thank you, Fran Depetrillo. Fran, thank you, Fran. We'll stay with that at 7:30. I'll get it right. And you're listening to KCR, Kingston Community Radio, AM 920 and 92.5 FM. My name is Dan Gatiss, and it is 7:30 a.m., and it's Monday, February 22nd, 25 degrees here in uptown Kingston. Snow showers early today, becoming steadier snow for the afternoon, 1 to 3 inches possible. Tonight, partly cloudy, low of 26, and Tuesday, cloudy skies with a shower of rain or wet snow possible, 30% chance of that, high of 42. And Tuesday night, a few clouds, low 28. Wednesday, partly cloudy with a high near 50. Wednesday night, partly cloudy with a low of 32. We'll be right back after these messages.
You're listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM. And also online at mykcr.org.
The Home Energy Assistance Program can help make winter a little warmer this season, with financial grants to eligible households to help pay heating or utility bills. Are you in need of assistance, or know someone who is? Find out more about the benefits and eligibility requirements of the HEAP program by contacting your county Department of Social Services, or by visiting the Assistance Program section of Central Hudson's website, centralhudson.com.
I may never have met you. We don't go way back. Maybe we wouldn't even be friends if we did. But when you wear a mask, you have my respect. Because your mask doesn't protect you. It protects me. I wear my mask to protect you. Mask up, America.
Brought to you by the Ad Council.
Hi, this is Scott Harrington from Hurley, and I support Kingston Community Radio because the people need a place to have their voice heard, and it's lost in corporate radio, so please keep listening and supporting our station.
And we're back, ready for our new guests, and this is WGHQ, AM 920 and 92.5 FM, the home of Kingston Community Radio, and your call-in number is 331-9255, and you can call in anytime, of course. We are also streaming worldwide at mykcr.org. And let's get back with the hosts today, Fran Depetrillo Savoca and Tony Marmo. Welcome back.
You did good, Dan, on that one.
I practiced it.
Well, welcome, folks. This is our next half hour segment. I don't know what this. I don't know if your show has a real name or not.
It doesn't.
Okay. Well, no. It would have been maybe like Fran and Lorraine in the morning or something like that. I don't know. That's kind of. Yeah. Okay. All right. And there it is.
Even this morning before I came in, I was like, we still don't have a name. Monday mornings, but that's okay.
No, I think we had said Marvelous Mondays. Marvelous Mondays. Not stinky, too trite. It's too, too used.
I would include Fran and Lorraine's name.
Yeah. All right.
I think Mondays with Fran and Lorraine are just fine. That's
just
great.
Fine.
Mondays.
Yeah. We just appreciate anybody
Mondays
who's
with Fran and Lorraine.
Tuned in and listening. And
yes. Thank you to our listeners and our sponsors. Absolutely.
Do we have our guests on the line? Hi, this is Fran. Do we have David and Kimberly?
Hi, Fran. No, it's just David this morning. I think it's a little early for Kimberly.
Oh, okay.
Good morning.
Hi,
Good
David.
Morning.
So we haven't had a chance to meet yet, and I don't think you've had a chance to meet Tony Marmo either. But we are so excited to have you on this morning. So, David, how do you pronounce your last name?
It's Bowed.
Bowed. Okay. Yes. And do I understand correctly you're the founder and chief executive of Salt Hotels?
That's right, yes.
Wow.
Okay, that's pretty good. We're impressed already, right
we're
off the
totally
bat.
We're totally impressed.
Should we be impressed, David?
No. But it's a great company, and we're really excited to be coming to Kingston as well. So we love the spot, and we're really excited to open in late April.
Right. So can you tell us a little bit about Salt Hotels, and then we'll go into our local opportunity here with you?
Can we just ask, too, because it sounds like he's not a native New Yorker.
Oh, yeah.
That's right. So,
can you just give a little background on yourself?
Yes.
I grew up in a small village just outside Manchester, England, called Salt, which is where my parents still live. And so that was one of the main factors of naming Salt Hotels. And I moved to America in 2007.
Oh, wow.
I've been in hotels all my life, really. I started as a bellman when I was 15 years old. And,
wow.
That's a long time ago now. And,
well, 10 years is pretty good to be in the business. You sound like a young guy. You know, no kidding.
No. that's the beauty of radio, right?
Yeah. Are you saying you have a face for radio, David?
So I've been in hotels all my life and worked for some of sort of the great leaders of our industry. I worked for Ian Traeger for 12 years, who really invented and created the boutique hotel. Mm. And then Andre Balazs for many years, and then started Salt Hotels in 2014. We currently have two hotels in Provincetown, Cape Cod, two hotels in Asbury Park, New Jersey, and then this will be our fifth opening in a few weeks.
Well, we're
okay.
A good company.
So is Salt House Inn in Provincetown?
Yes.
Okay.
Right.
You been there?
I've
been
walked
by it?
By. Yeah, it sounded so familiar, and I couldn't figure out why.
Gorgeous
and
up there, right?
Yeah.
Beautiful park.
Oh, my gosh, yeah. That's lovely.
Yeah.
Well, now I'll just view things.
So how did we get in such a elite company? Well, Asbury is kind of a cool town in itself, and,
yes.
And Provincetown is obviously gorgeous.
My grandmother grew up in Asbury.
How did Kingstown get to be
Tony.
on your list? How did Kingston get selected, David?
I'm sorry, you broke up a little.
Oh, I'm sorry about that. So we're curious, you know, we're in good company with Provincetown and Asbury. How did we get selected? How did Kingston get selected? For you?
Yeah. So we have been looking in Catskills, upstate New York now for many years. We really love the area, and our guests all talk about the area, and they want to, you know, a lot of our guests come from New York City, and so they wanted us to do something. And we were introduced to Carl Sloven, who had bought Hudson Brickyard.
Mm-hmm.
He'd bought it about 7 years ago, 7 or 8 years ago now, and he was looking for a hospitality partner. And when we first met, first of all, you go to the site and it's love at first sight. It is just spectacular, and I truly believe that there's nothing else like it. And then chatting with Carl and, you know, touring Kingston, meeting some people, getting introduced to people through friends of friends, we were just convinced immediately this is something we really have to do. And and funnily enough, because of the nature of the site, because it's so well spread out, because it's individual cabins, it's almost like it was planned to be opened in this sort of COVID time. And so whilst it never was, it's just perfect for ensuring physical distancing and everything else. And so it truly was one of those love at first sight opportunities, and we're very, very happy to be coming.
Great, great. You know, the other two are also by water. Is that a criteria for you?
It's not a criteria, but it's certainly a preference. We love the the water, and this site being right on the Hudson River is so unique that it's the perfect match for our other properties as well.
Yeah, can you explain what's going to be on the property, how it's going to be set up, or what could a client or visitor or customer expect?
Yeah, absolutely. So, one of the things that Carl really wanted to achieve, and we wholeheartedly agree with, is sort of this, making the site very accessible, allowing people to come on site. And so with that, we have 25 cabins, and about half of those have uninterrupted river views, and then we have a small spa, so you can get some wellness treatments while you're with us. We'll have a restaurant and bar that'll also be riverside. Lots of fun opportunities for wellness and health with hikes, guided kayaking. We have beehives on the site. We will have a small archery range, some small game areas, an outdoor gym.
Wow.
And of course, it's for those people that have been to the site before, it also has three incredibly large pavilions, which are great for events. So we hope to be continuing to host weddings and special events and concerts. The concert market really isn't happening right now. We will be working with the Bowery Presents, who we work with in Asbury Park, and who Carl had already been working with in Kingston, and so we'll be partnering with them when concerts do come back. We hope to have some on the smaller side, but some really fun and interesting concerts, and hopefully some local performers as well.
Wow, that sounds really appealing. And give us and the listeners an idea about timing for the project, and where you're at. And I know that's probably up in the air with the lovely plague that we're dealing with. But what's your idea about timing?
Yeah, we're planning right now that we will open the very end of April or early May. So in preparation for the summer season, we have we are currently holding we hold a school called Salt School, which started 3 weeks ago, and that's every Saturday. We have about 100 people attending that school, which is great. All from the local area, and really that's sort of teaching people about hospitality and what our hotels are about. Getting a chance to meet a lot of people, and hopefully with a view that we'll be recruiting a lot of those people when we come to open. And we're also taking general applications for employment as well right now. So it all looks on track. I'm going to hedge my bets a little bit and say probably early May. But I think we'll be ready for that date.
It's so exciting. And the Salt School that you were talking a little bit about, can you elaborate a little bit more on that? And how often do you do that? Or is it just when you open a new property?
It's an 8 week every Saturday morning school. Normally it's in person, but with the current situation, we're doing it virtually. And we hope that by the end of it, when the weather's warmed up a little bit, we'll be able to do a little bit of it in person outside and socially distanced. But we cover all aspects of hospitality, all of the different departments. And I think a lot of people don't understand or don't realize how many different departments there are in a hotel, whether that's housekeeping, front desk, food and beverage, restaurant, bar, Or administration, you know, revenue management, accounting. There's also sales and marketing. So, you know, there's so many different facets to hospitality and to hotels. And I'm very passionate about introducing people into our little hospitality world. And, you know, I think what's such a big advantage of hotels and hospitality is, you know, I left high school with no formal qualifications at all. And I worked in every department in a hotel. And then I ended up running some of the best hotels in the world. Right. And I think that, you know, that's a great opportunity for anyone. And it's all about attitude. It's all about really wanting to look after our guests. And so our company motto is hire the attitude and train the skill, because I can train any computer systems or how to make a bed or any of those things. But, you know, you have to come in with the right attitude and the attitude of really wanting to help people. And so, so the school really, you know, introduces people to the different, departments. Mm. And then as part of our ongoing conversation, we sort of collectively say which is probably going to be the best position for each individual person. And so so it's also a bit of a you know, it's a long interview from the candidate and from us, so everyone right. gets a chance to meet each other, which has been really, really good and so engaging. I mean, I've been watching the breakout sessions, and there's a lot of role playing and a lot of fun things that happen.
Well, it's a fun industry, and it's like you said, there are so many aspects to it and so many different departments and skill sets. So this is amazing what you're doing. I love it. How many people did you say were enrolled this time around?
It was just under 100 people.
Wow. Yeah, that's so pretty good.
Yeah.
You know, I'm in the employment. I own an employment agency in Kingston, and I can tell you that, you know, the challenge that we're living through with the pandemic, you know, and folks on collecting unemployment and thinking that that's a job, you know, it's a little mystifying to me that, you know, folks are happy to be on unemployment when there's plenty of jobs out there, and yours is a good case in point, that there's a great opportunity that's before them, you know, and you can certainly, let's say, tip your or put your toe in the water in terms of do you like it? You're and you can see on the other end. It's a great idea, by the way. Love the idea for a period of time. You're seeing if someone's there on time, if they're dressed appropriately, and how they conduct themselves. And if they're serious about the opportunity. So kudos to you for coming up with that concept of the hospitality school. Makes sense.
Do the students that are coming to the school, how did you recruit them from the local area?
We did a lot of local Facebook advertising. We took adverts out in some of the local papers. And what we found is that it's predominantly word of mouth. Mm-hmm. You know, it's and that's always the most positive way of doing it. When we put the post on Facebook, and I think it had something like 3,000 shares on it.
Yeah, that's great.
Which is a lot of it is, you know, I read all of the application letters, and the application process is very simple, and it's just tell us why you want to do this. It's not, you know, again, we don't need to go into qualifications and experience. This is much more about, you know, we can help you if this is a career that you're interested in. And and to answer your earlier question, yeah. Fran, what we do is this is the first one, but I envisage, you know, this is sort of our opening year, and I think, you know, we'll hopefully book a lot more weddings as we go forward. And what we've done in Asbury Park in the past is as we've got a little bit bigger and a little bit busier, we've held other SALT schools in over the years as well. So this is a major one for us right now, but I hope that, you know, as we continue to grow, that we'll have you know, we'll be needing more employees, and so we'll be able to do it again.
Well, it's a great thing to have, and we don't have a lot of that around here, to my knowledge, so I'm so grateful that you are doing this training.
I mean, there's obviously some other hospitality venues that are, you know, pretty classic, like Mohonk up there, you know,
true.
On the mountain. And,
true, they have an extensive training program.
Yeah, they do. But this, I think it's a great idea, and I think the combination of, you know, being that 70 plus acres or whatever it is of property there on the Hudson just draws people. I mean, I think it's going to be a great location and venue for weddings and concerts and other gatherings.
And with the new portion of the trail that's opened up and everybody's, you know, out getting their fresh air and activity, and they can see what you're doing there, and it's just so appealing, and everybody's so curious. So I'm really grateful that you came on today. For our listeners that maybe tuned in afterwards, we're talking with David Bowd. Is that correct, David?
That's correct. Yes.
From Salt Hotels, founder and chief executive from Salt Hotels, and end of April, beginning of May, hopefully, you'll be opening Salt property at Hutton Brickyards. So exciting. So,
David, do you live down in Manhattan?
I do. I live in the financial district of Manhattan, and I spend all of my time on the road in hotels. So right now I'm in actually calling you from Cape Cod right now.
Oh, good for you.
Very nice.
Yeah, good for you. It's because there's probably not many people in Manhattan these days. Well, there's millions still, but the streets are probably still pretty empty. But still, again, you know, kudos, because even in, you know, regular old times, you know, this is a challenging endeavor. I think, you know, if you layer the pandemic over it and all the rules and regulations and the physical distancing requirements, it's really a challenge. So good for you for sticking with it, and seemingly you're on track to open in the warm weather coming with the, you know, sounds like it.
Yeah, I think so, and you know, a lot of the hard work had already been done. It had been done prior to last summer by Carl and his team of, you know, utilities and all of the major digging and all of that side of things. So we get to come in and really do the fun stuff of making it look great and you know, putting the soul in, which is really the team members. As you were just saying, I mean, the timing is perfect, and along with the Empire State Trail, which is fascinating of how many people every day are there and taking walks, and so I think it's great that it's now all opening up at the same time, and you know, we've worked very closely with the mayor and the city offices for Salt School and for, you know, getting the hotel open. And so it's nice to be coming to such a positive and great community.
Are you members of the chamber yet? Our Ulster County chamber?
Yes. I believe we are. And I think, yes, we've been members for quite a while.
Okay, so, good. Yeah. Yeah.
We'll all get to meet in person, I hope.
Yeah, I hope so. Yeah. Looking forward to meeting you. You should, reach out to them, to become a feature. Fran worked there for a long time, and I was on the board for a number of years for our local chamber. And, it'd be a great opportunity, if you haven't done so already, to, be the featured speaker at, they're still Zooming, but nonetheless, they still get a pretty good turnout for their breakfasts, and you know, that I think that'd be a great idea for you to get some more exposure and give some contact information, please, David, in terms of, you know, if anyone has a question or may be interested in the school or something else. Can you give some contact info, please?
Yeah, absolutely. The best is email, which is very simple. info@salthotels.com, and that comes straight through to my office. So, I'm happy to answer any questions. And as I say, we're still you know, anybody that's interested in employment as well can use that. And we have a team on the ground that is busily recruiting. I mean, we're looking, all in all, we'll have about 70 staff joining us this summer. So
that's great.
We've got a lot of people to hire, and we're looking for great people.
Good. Okay.
Well, we certainly hope you find them, and we are so excited that you found Kingston and the Hutton Brickyard property, because we're thrilled to have you here in Ulster County.
David, I'll get your email address from Fran. Send you a link to our YouTube. Each show gets recorded. We post it up on our YouTube channel, so we'll send you a link so you can listen to how good you sound.
Great. Thank you very much, and it's been great talking to you both.
Yeah, same here. Be well and be safe, and good luck with the project.
Yes. Thank you, David.
Thank you.
All Bye-bye. The best.
Enjoy Provincetown.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, well, that's interesting. You know, it's should be, you know, adding a whole new project of that kind to the labor market, though, is going to be, I think, a little challenging. But we'll see. You know, it's a phone call, Dan, or not? No?
No, I was just saying goodbye.
Oh, okay. Yeah, David's a good guy. So, yeah, I mean, it's, I mean, no, that project has been, well, that area has been kind of up for grabs a little bit, it seems like, right? In terms of what to do with it. But sounds like they found a
Perfect find.
Yeah.
Especially with the success history that Salt Hotels has.
So. Yeah, absolutely.
So excited.
And the influx, you know, I was yesterday visiting uptown Kingston. A lot of folks walking around the street. A lot of younger folks.
Uptown.
They had that Manhattan look about them, or that Brooklyn look about them.
That tourist look.
That tourist
yeah.
look.
That deer in the headlights
yeah,
look.
Yeah, like looking up and around. And
we are the drive market. I mean, who wouldn't want to come here, Tony?
Yeah, I know. It's great.
We're the perfect weekend getaway.
It really is. And I think people maybe have a little trepidation still, obviously, with the pandemic. And but I think that's easing up a little bit.
But a little trepidation. I don't think they have trepidation about coming here.
No. It's about, with just getting out, generally speaking, although, you know, they're outside walking around. And
But we have plenty of safe accommodations and restaurants. And
yeah, absolutely.
All the incredible recreation you could ask for.
Yeah, I mean,
So great stuff.
Yeah, so that's very interesting. And the tourism world is really alive and well, I think, you know.
Yes,
right?
Doing great. If anybody is looking for any information, our website is ulstercountyalive.com. It has everything you could be looking for.
Yeah.
Shopping, restaurants, recreation, accommodations.
Right.
Yeah.
And really, if you think about it as a job market, you know, as a segment, I mean, it's huge.
This industry?
You know, the tourism industry is huge.
Absolutely huge.
I chuckle when people say, well, there's no work around here.
Oh, there's always work.
There's
and
work.
There's, it's you know, almost I mean, always it, yeah. tourism related.
Yeah.
No matter.
I mean, again, during the pandemic, it's been a little tight. Certainly in some places, you know, hospitality related have had some difficulty, I think everyone kind of feels pretty much that we're closer to the end of this thing than we are the beginning now, right? I mean,
lots of plans of getting regulations in order for more things to open up and large events to be happening.
Seems
and
like it.
Lisa Berger, Director of Tourism, is really our numbers person.
Yeah.
So if Lisa's listening and she wants to call in and share things like tourism being the second biggest economic generator in the county or how many people it employs in the county, if she wants to call in, 331-9255. Let us know those numbers.
Used to be IBM was the major employer. Now it's tourism.
It's tourism.
Really?
Yeah.
You know, that's what it is. And so...
like David was saying, I mean, it's every aspect of every department you can think of. So,
Yeah. And I think the population shift, you know, out of the metropolitan areas is going to continue. especially with people having ability to work remotely, right? That's another.
Sure.
We were talking earlier about technology and how it has helped us and maybe how it's hurt us. The help part is remote working, right? You can sit in the comforts of your home and pretty much conduct your, a lot of people can. My son, you know, they live in, and daughter-in-law, they live in Long Island and Huntington, and they're remoting. I mean, you know, they both work in the city, you know, but so they live in Huntington, Long Island area, Centerport, and
so they're skipping the commute and getting it all done at home?
Skipping the commute.
It's great.
Yeah. I mean, I think maybe that'll change a little bit when they open back up. But, yeah, if you own commercial real estate in New York City, you're kind of hoping that things change quickly because there's a lot of empty space down there.
You need to
get
creative.
Folks are,
do we have somebody on the phone?
Or we don't. We don't. We
is
don't.
Raleigh coming in? Or?
One hopes.
Okay.
We're good to go. Yeah, we're good to go. Take it away, Dan.
Thanks, Dan.
Okay, and thank you, Tony Marmo and Fran Depetrillo Savoca, and a very, very special thanks to David Bowd from Salt Hotels. You're here with us at KCR, Kingston Community Radio, AM 920 and 92.5 FM. It is 8 o'clock AM, Monday, February 22nd. 25 degrees here in Uptown Kingston. This last quarter of Kingston Community Radio has been brought to you by Central Hudson. And weather and forecast for Kingston and the surrounding areas. We've got some snow coming. We've got 1 to 3 inches possible. Some steadier snow in the afternoon. And a high of 34. Tonight, partly cloudy, a low of 26. Tuesday, cloudy skies and a shower of rain or wet snow possible. 30% chance of that for tomorrow, high of 42. Tomorrow night, a few clouds, low 28. And Wednesday, partly cloudy, a high near 50. Wednesday night, partly cloudy, a low of 32. And most schools are closed and or doing remote learning all day. We've got Red Hook schools closed. Offices are open. Rhinebeck schools closed. Rondout Valley Central School District, remote learning only. Saugerty Central School District closed. Center for Spectrum Services, remote only today. And New Paltz Central School District is closed. Onteora, remote only. Woodstock Day School, remote only. Mountain Top schools closed. Kingston City School District, remote. And it's a snow day. It's a remote snow day. And Upton Lake School closed. And we'll be back after these messages.
You're listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM. And also online at mykcr.org.
The Home Energy Assistance Program can help make winter a little warmer this season, with financial grants to eligible households to help pay heating or utility bills. Are you in need of assistance, or know someone who is? Find out more about the benefits and eligibility requirements of the HEAP program by contacting your County Department of Social Services, or by visiting the Assistance Program section of Central Hudson's website, centralhudson.com.
I may never have met you. We don't go way back. Maybe we wouldn't even be friends if we did. But when you wear a mask, you have my respect. Because your mask doesn't protect you. It protects me. I wear my mask to protect you. Mask up, America.
Brought to you by the Ad Council.
Hi, this is Cameron Rylance from Kingston, and I support Kingston Community Radio because it's informative.
Thank you for being with us on WGHQ AM 920 and 92.5 FM, the home of Kingston Community Radio. My name is Dan Gatiss. It is 8:03 a.m. Monday, February 22nd, 25 degrees here in Uptown Kingston. And this following segment of KCR is brought to you by Herzog's. At Herzog's Home and Paint Center, community, family, and neighborhood all matter. Their employees have been a part of the Herzog's family for years, and they value personal customer service, being close to their community. Stop by at Herzog's Home and Paint Center in the Kingston Plaza for all of your home building, maintenance, and painting needs. Discover the difference of buying local. And sales are ongoing at herzogs.com. Check them out. And it is Monday, February 22nd, 25 degrees here in Uptown Kingston. Let's get back to the on-air studio with Fran Depetrillo, Savoca, and Tony Marmo. Welcome back.
Yeah, thanks, Dan. We're back, and this is Tony Marmo.
And Fran Depetrillo, Savoca.
And this
good
is
Monday morning.
Good Monday morning, yes, to everybody. And even though the snow is coming, be chipper because this spring, it's supposed to get warm this week, isn't it?
Is just yeah. Not today. Yeah,
it's 50-ish on Wednesday.
Yeah, like 48-ish. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, so I don't know. I'm going skiing on Thursday.
So are you?
I think so. In the morning after the show.
Where will you be skiing?
Well, I think probably Bel Air. Yeah.
Very good.
They've done a nice job. I haven't been there since they put a big addition on the Discovery Lodge at the bottom, and had my first ride in the gondola.
Oh, very nice.
It was cool. And yeah, the mountain was in great shape and people were super nice. And, you know, last Friday, was it? I don't know. One day. Oh, because it was the holiday weekend. And it was crowded. It started getting crowded around lunchtime. And a lot of folks there. But yeah, 'tis the season. You know, it's been a great snow season for skiing.
Yes.
So probably not happy that, you know, people have to shovel it and move it and plow it and spend money doing that. But
who do we have on the phone?
Oh, maybe we might have Raleigh Green on the phone. We'll see. We shall see. Because he's supposed to be calling in. Okay. Good morning. You're on the air. Is this Raleigh?
No, hey, Tony, Cat Frans, Cameron.
Hi, Cam.
Cam Rylance. How are you?
I'm doing great. Hey, Tony, thanks for the birthday wishes the other day. It was very nice. I was driving to work, and I was tickled.
Well,
Cameron, did you have a birthday? Happy birthday.
He did. Thank you. Yeah, the big 55. Hi, yeah, yeah.
Wow, you're speed limit, man.
Yes. but the reason I'm calling is I'm hoping that our last Salt Hotel guest was listening because I was driving. I couldn't call. I was in a bad area. But I have always thought that the Brickyard would make a fantastic marina. And now with the lodging you're offering there, the transient overnight slips, because boating along with RVing
Cameron, it's funny that you said that, because I meant to ask him if there's going to be any marina facility. That would be great for his tourism.
I feel as though there are going to be boat slips eventually. It takes a lot.
Scott Harrington can help him out with that.
Scott's doing his own thing down in Florida, catching.
I know, but he has experience running.
Yes, he does. Yes, he does. Yes, he does.
He can help out. But, I just think, you know, if they're listening, boy, I think that is a cash cow waiting to happen right on the river there. So.
Yeah, that's a great idea, Cam. I presume the depth there is fine. I mean, I'm not sure.
You don't, yeah. Yeah. They could work it out, a little digging, I guess.
No, that would be it.
I couldn't help because I just crossed the bridge. I'm looking at it as I was driving. I was like, there's got to be boats down there. But
yeah, no, that's a great idea. And it should be a really interesting project.
Because so much of the creek is limited with docking, you know, because of the way the shoreline is. And, there's not much room for expansion of a boat docks, transient docks. So out in the river there would be great if possible.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a great idea. Fran, as we speak, is typing a little email to David, and if he answers, we'll share it on the air.
Tell him KCO is looking out for him. So
yes, will do. Thanks, Cam.
Thinking. Cool. All right, guys, sounds good. I just wanted to drop that in there because I
appreciate that, brother. All the best. We'll see you soon. Keep up a terrific Tuesday. You guys are awesome. You and Nina are spectacular.
Thank you so much,
Cam.
Love it.
All the best.
All right, guys. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. We have another caller. Oh, birthdays. Yeah, there are none. Unless I missed one.
Somebody must have a birthday.
Yeah, that would be zero. No birthdays today. I'm sure okay. Somebody has a birthday.
Yeah. The folder is empty.
It's empty.
There's no reason for that.
People have birthdays today.
That's right.
There's nobody that I know really well, because that'd be bad if I am not wishing them a happy birthday.
Right.
But I am going to go to Facebook and look. Raleigh has not called in yet.
Raleigh has not.
Yeah, I met Raleigh through the Ulster County Regional Chamber of Commerce.
Oh, no kidding.
Yes, it's how I've met many, 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 many people in this community.
Yeah, yeah.
How many, all thanks
many,
to
many years did you work there?
I did a fabulous 10-year stint. It was like overnight, but that's because I loved it so much. 10 years with the Ulster County Regional Chamber of Commerce. And like, what an incredible opportunity. But it all started before working there through the Ulster County Leadership Development Institute that Ingrid Kulik, through the foundation, the Chamber Foundation, runs. And it's such an incredible program, and it's grown so much over the years.
Yeah,
and
so influential.
Every year is a new group of people that are ready to serve on boards and connected into the community, and just incredible.
I'd like to say I remember when we started that, because I was on the Chamber Board, I don't know, seemed like
the Leadership Institute,
for a decade, or I think I was on for like 12 years.
Was it 1991, 92?
I think so.
With the first graduating class,
I think
possibly
so.
In 92.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
And I might not have been on then, but I know I was on during Len Cain's time, which was a long time. He was, well, the war's getting close. Well, I mean,
let's see. So,
yeah,
what year? This is like trivia. Ulster County Regional Chamber of Commerce trivia. What year did Ward?
Maybe Ward Todd can call in and enlighten us.
Yeah, call us, Ward.
331-9255. Maybe he can just give us a little.
But see,
refresher.
Without Googling, I'm going to try to think of what year Ward started.
Right, it's a bar bet. No,
we're
I can tell you.
Albany Avenue.
Oh, yeah, for sure, I, because I was on the search committee, and that was, I was still at Kingston Hospital. I want to say it was 2002 or 3 for Ward. Let's see, 2002 or 1,
yeah,
1, 1 or 2, 1 or 2, because I left Kingston Hospital
right time frame.
August of 2003, and I was, I think, it was about a year before I left the hospital, so.
So maybe it was 2... Maybe he did start in like the spring of 2003.
I think so. Yeah, I think that's correct. I think that's pretty good. And then Leadership Institute, that started, I'm trying to think who started that with Len. And I don't think it was Ingrid back then, or maybe it was. So we might need to Google that one. But the Chamber is a great organization and continues to do a great job. KCR is happy to be part of the Chamber, and I think it's relevant even these days with the pandemic going on. It gives people an opportunity to still come together. You know, they're Zooming, which, you know, I guess
they're Zooming.
Yeah.
Whoever thought we'd be?
Yeah, that whole
that
word
that
is
way.
Just taken on a whole different context now, right? Zoom.
Okay, so I have heard from David.
Oh, good.
From Salt Hotels.
Oh, good.
And he was thrilled to be on the radio. And yes, the plan is they would love to have a place to dock in the future. So it won't be happening this end of April, early May when they open. But the plan is to have a place to dock, which that is super exciting.
Nice. Okay, well, that's good. That's good to know. Cameron Rylance.
Yes, thanks for asking, Cameron.
So... okay. So we're trying to get Ward Todd to call in, but he's tied up right now.
Okay.
And so he's, well, not literally tied up, but he's on another call. So 331-9255, give us a call if you want to talk about, tourism or anything Kingston, right?
Anything Kingston.
Anything Kingston. Now, how is the tourism, you know, are you feeling that there's a sense of folks wanting to start to, are they calling? Are they inquiring? What's happening?
Oh, yes. Yes.
People are starting to plan a little bit, maybe some summer vacations, or anticipating that they can get around with a vaccine and with a mask.
Yeah.
And
I mean, camping coming up,
camping.
Like,
yeah.
you better book it now because you're not going to get in anywhere.
Right.
People are finding us. People, third quarter of 2020 was amazing for tourism.
Yeah, we do have a call. Good morning, caller. You're on KCR. What's your question or comment?
Well, good morning, Tony. How are you?
Hey, Mike, pretty good. How are you? How are you feeling?
I'm doing good.
Good.
Doing well.
Glad to hear that.
I'm getting my second vaccine tomorrow.
Oh, good for you. Where are you getting that one? Not on your body, per se, but where? What's the what location?
Our temple made arrangements with Neil Smolin.
Oh, Neil Smolin from Woodstock,
To do those who were...
Great.
65 and over, and who have underlying conditions.
Great. Beautiful. Very good.
We had our first round, somewhere around the 26th or so of January, and tomorrow is supposed to be the second. So, obviously, I'm a little concerned about the way people have reacted to the second, but I think we'll come through it okay.
Yeah, I'm sure. Are you excited a little bit about baseball starting? And
it's a nice feeling. I was just reading a thing in the sports section that Domingo Amon was coming back from being suspended for domestic violence, is speaking to his teammates, and is looking to talk to people.
Yep.
And I think that when people are involved in situations like that, and you're able to speak about it, it's a good thing because I believe that America gives second chances to most people. And I mean, because they have a second chance to make good on for themselves. And I hope this young man does exactly that.
Well, right. Look, I mean, baseball is probably a passing phase for him, but it's his profession right now, so it would behoove him to kind of figure out his life and apologize to the people he needs to apologize to, obviously including his partner.
He let a lot of people down.
Yeah.
You know, he let his teammates down. He let you know, the fans down, and most of all, he let his family down.
Yeah, correct. So he's got a little work to do. But
I mean, I think that in any profession, your family has to come first.
Absolutely.
And one thing that's making this winter rather interesting is seeing the Knicks play some basketball.
Yeah, I mean, they're watchable again. You know, they
really are. I watched a game last night. They had a 20-point lead, and
almost gave it away.
They blew it, almost blew it.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, okay, here's thoughts. You know, I don't think they make playoffs this year, but
well, I don't know about that. They're in the mix, man.
Tom Thibodeau seems to be a pretty good coach. I mean, he did well in Chicago and in other places.
The guys
hopefully hopefully. These free agents who want to play elsewhere other than New York will start saying, hey, maybe the Garden's a good place again.
Yeah. No, I think the Knicks make the playoffs this year. I think they're going to make another trade. They're going to, they're going to bring another piece in, offensive piece. And Thibodeau is a great leader.
Oh, you do think they're going to make the playoffs?
Oh, right? I do. Yeah, I do. Definitely do. I think they're on a good run and streak, and they're starting to believe in themselves. And the Nets are, the other Brooklyn team, the other New York team is those three guys are going to make the All-Star team. Starters, right?
I believe that.
Yeah, that's what's going to happen. They're going to get voted in.
I'm not even sure that I like the idea of the All-Star game this year with the COVID and all of that.
Yeah.
But I guess it's a good thing.
Yeah. It's TV ratings, man. All right, Michael, we got
TV ratings, that's about it.
we got to scoot on. Good for you, and say hello to Adele. Thanks for listening and
guys,
supporting
KCR. Guys, have a great day. I'm enjoying your show.
Thanks.
And everybody be safe.
Yes,
thank you
too, man.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
What's a little more snow, right? Friday snow was absolutely beautiful, though.
Oh, it's cool. I'll tell you, I was just in awe of the scenery and the way the snow was clinging to the trees. It's like, I mean, I'm not going to say it's as beautiful as a summer day, but it was pretty nice. It was pretty nice.
It was the closest one, the closest day, the way it was cascading in the air gorgeous. All day long.
It was like, that Chevy Chase movie where he said, cue the deer, you know.
Yes, right, yeah.
I can't remember where that was. Raleigh, is this you? Good morning, caller. You're on Casey.
Good morning. Hi.
You're not Raleigh.
Okay. How are you today?
Good. How are you, Evelyn?
Yeah, I'm doing good, too.
What's happening?
First of all, a lot of people are concerned about getting their second shot. And I got mine on the 17th of this month, and nothing happened with it at all. You know, I had no ill effects from it or anything.
Good.
You know, it's, I know some people have had problems with it, but more people have not.
So you've had your first and your second shot.
I had my second shot, yes.
And do you mind my asking if it was Moderna or Pfizer?
I don't know which one I got.
Okay. And you didn't have side effects?
I had gone up to Woodstock and had gotten it up there.
Okay.
I didn't realize that it wasn't set up until the day they got it. I live in senior housing and Stogby's here.
Well, we are glad you got your shot.
I heard we had substantially Moderna because there was some refrigeration issues that couldn't be figured out with the Pfizer. But you know what? They're going to start coming out now in buckets, I think, because, you know, other companies are going to start making them. I mean, by the summertime, you're going to be able to get it you can get I think it's going to be in big numbers pretty soon.
Okay.
Okay. One other thing I want to mention, because I know Mike was on before, and he was saying you're supposed to be getting his tomorrow, Neil. Okay, Neil also had come to the housing where I live. I live on 155 Main Street. And he came on the, I think it was on the 26th of this month, and he's supposed to be coming tomorrow to come out. But then we got a call saying that he was not able to get the serum.
Mm-hmm.
So they're not going to be coming here. I know they had gone to the mill and other places. So I hope Mike is going to get his. I don't know where he went and got it.
But well, he said it was through the synagogue.
Yep.
That's kind of how those arrangements were made. Temple Emmanuel, I believe, is where it's going to be. But not sure of that. But I think it's going to start becoming more plentiful. I was reading something today where another, X millions are going to be distributed. And so hopefully New York State is on the list for that. And folks have the opportunity to get the vaccine if they so desire. There's people that don't want it, and there's people that want it, and those that want it should get it.
Yeah, definitely.
And those that don't should.
You said it's going to be more available, but I know here we were told for tomorrow that we're not going to be getting it unless between today and tomorrow he does get the serum.
Right. So there you go.
That people will get it.
Right. Well, thank you for calling, Evelyn. Have a great day and be safe.
Thank
be well.
You too, and keep safe and keep well and keep dry. In warm.
Yes, yeah, warm, yeah, warm, be warm.
Warm, right?
Yeah.
Okay, take care, it's good talking to you.
Yes, thanks, be well. All right, so you're listening to KCR on either 92.5 FM, 920 AM. Do people listen on 920 AM?
Absolutely.
They do?
Yeah, absolutely.
I am so impressed with that.
Yeah, they get them all.
That's a throwback to prior technology days, AM radio.
It's like simulcast. It's on
simulcast, or you can listen.
It's AM 920, and it's also booted out at 92.5 FM.
Right, and also if you want to go on mykcr.org, you can hit the little
see everybody's link pretty face
and see. But you can listen, far and wide that way. I mean,
that is a very, very good way to.
And if you're technologically, up. So you can listen right on your phone by hitting YouTube and typing in Kingston Community Radio.
Yep.
We want to thank our underwriters and for supporting us and the listeners. We have a KCR fundraiser, an all-day fundraiser on March 31st, Fran. Did you know that?
March March 31st fundraiser?
March 31st fundraiser.
I love it. Tell me more.
Yeah. Well, we're gonna have a full day, almost like the Happy Christmas Fund, but we're going to do it right here in the studio, and we're going to raise money for funds for, I almost said funny. cross between funny funds money. And money.
Funny money.
For KCR. We do have a caller. Raleigh, is this you? Oh, my gosh. Raleigh.
No, it's not Raleigh.
Hi, Lisa.
Is it Lisa? You know,
it's Lisa Berger. How are you, Lisa Berger?
I'm good. I've been sitting over here listening to you guys. I happened to be in the office early this morning, and I know that you've been waiting for Raleigh.
Well, Raleigh is out of my will now, so I mean that's it. He's been crossed out. I had $100,000 set aside for him in the will. It's out. Yeah. He's out. He's
and,
out. He's,
and Lisa says she just happened to be in
maybe
early.
Maybe Lisa, you've she's, replaced Raleigh.
She's
as
always
the,
in
the will. How are you?
Lisa Berger. She's the director of tourism. Do you know Lisa?
No, okay. Yes, of course.
How's it going?
Everything's good, you guys.
Good.
Since Raleigh's not here to give you an update on all the fantastic things that are probably happening in Kingston, I can just, you know, quickly, touch on a couple things we're looking forward to in the department. And I know, Fran, you had Hudson on this morning.
Yeah, David,
spectacular.
Fabulous.
Yeah, yeah. He's great. He's a person that probably needs to get a little bit more airtime or FaceTime or what time, mm-hmm. right? It's a great project. Plus, you got to love the English voice, the accent.
Yeah.
It's unfair.
Yes. Yes, he's magnificent. Did Fran tell you that I was lucky enough to go down there and peek inside one of those saunas that faces the river?
I did not share that.
Wow. Nice.
So do tell.
Yeah, tell us what it's like.
Oh, it's all glass. And the way that these are situated, you almost feel like you're sitting on the water. It is just spectacular. I can't say enough about how great that is. But, you know, we have a couple other, you know, fantastic things that we're looking forward to opening, like Hudson House, which is in West Park. And that's really going to be a home for Star Vodka. We think that they should be open in May, too.
Wow. So say it again. What is it? Star Vodka?
So it's the name of the project is actually the Hudson House. And it's in, I don't remember exactly which monastery it was. It's across the street Christian Brothers.
Your neighborhood.
Yeah.
Do you
know
where I mean, Tony?
Yes, yes, yes. I think they used to be an Episcopalian, possibly. Yeah, I know where you mean. Yep.
And so it looks like an Italian villa kind of half of
yes,
it. And
yes,
the other
yes, yes. It's by Cabrini.
So they're putting in a boutique hotel with a restaurant and rooftop bar, some event space, and a craft distillery that's going to use New York State greens. And they're going to produce bourbon, rye, and whiskey. And then, of course, it's the home of Star Vodka, which is this boutique vodka brand that had started, I think, a few years ago down in the city, but it is sourced from New York State. So Hudson House will become the home of Star Vodka.
Great. Okay, that's good news. I think I know where you mean. Is it by the, West Park Winery called now? Red Maple?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's by in that neck of the woods. So it's another wedding venue. So that means a lot of people should be getting married. I mean, are we promoting that?
Well, it's a distillery, a boutique inn.
Oh, right.
They can, yeah.
They can do a bunch of things, not just get married.
Not just get married.
Okay. Well, all right.
But we like it when people get married. Don't you love a good wedding?
Yes. Especially when you don't have to wear a mask and, you know, bubble wrap and all that stuff.
we're waiting to find out actually what those regulations are going to be now that the governor raised he raised the limit, the number of people that can attend a wedding. And now we're just waiting to hear what all the regulations are going to be behind that. So it's now you're allowed up to 150 people or 50% capacity of a venue. Whichever one is less. Like, you can't go over 150.
Gotcha. Yeah, that's good. I think, as I said earlier, I think the end is at least in sight of this happy times that we're in. All right, Lise, we need to go. We're getting near the bottom of the hour, so thank you for calling.
Lisa.
Thank you for your support of KCR, and we'll see you real soon.
Okay, great.
Appreciate the calling.
Yep, bye.
All right. So you want to welcome our guest?
Yes.
And then we're going to go to break, and we can start again.
Yes, we have Amberly Campbell from Kingston Wire, and I have to admit, I don't know a lot about Kingston Wire, so I'm super excited for this next half hour to talk to Amberly.
Okay, so that's a little teaser. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Welcome. I can't wait, too. Are you a local person?
I'm originally from Highland.
Oh, no kidding.
So I did party a lot in Kingston as a youth.
Okay, okay. You have a vowel at the end of your other name or your last name?
My maiden name was Timperio, yes.
Oh, there you go.
Yep. How'd you guess?
How did I guess? Is Sal a relation to you?
Yes, my cousin.
Oh,
yep.
There you go.
Yep. Good old Sal.
Well, I lived in Highland for, we lived there for about 20 years, from 85 until about 05 or 06. My boys graduated, my young men graduated high school from Highland, so hung around there for a long time. Still have many, many, many friends, and most of them have vowels at the end of their name.
It's true.
All right, Dan, you want to take us to break?
Okay, thank you, Tony, Marmo, and Fran Depetrillo, Savoca, and you are with us on KCR, Kingston Community Radio, AM 920 and 92.5 FM WGHQ. It's Monday, February 22nd, 25 degrees here in Uptown Kingston, and this last portion of Kingston Community Radio has been brought to you by Herzog's. Stop by Herzog's Home and Paint Center in the Kingston Plaza for all of your home building, maintenance, and painting needs. Discover the difference of buying local. Sales are ongoing at Herzog's.com, and it's the largest painting supplies center in the entire area. And weather and forecast for Kingston and the surrounding areas. We've got about 1 to 3 inches of snow coming today. Steadier in the afternoon, and it's a high of 34 degrees. Tonight, partly cloudy, a low of 26. Tuesday, cloudy skies with a possible wet snow or shower, 30% chance, and a high of 42. Tuesday night, a few clouds, a low down to 28. Wednesday, partly cloudy, a high all the way up to about 50. Wednesday night, partly cloudy, a low of 32. And school districts are closed today. Red Hook School closed. Offices are open, though. Rhinebeck School closed. Rondout Valley Central School District, remote learning only. Saugerty Central School District closed. Center for Spectrum Services, remote today only. New Paltz Central School District closed. Onteora, remote only. Mountaintop School closed. Woodstock Day School, remote only day today. Kingston City School District, remote snow day. And we'll be right back.
You're listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM. And also online at mykcr.org.
We are Lions. We bring hope where it's needed. We are a global force for good. Support causes that matter. Change lives. Change communities. Change the world. We can do more together than we can alone. Join in. Experience the joy of serving. Be part of the movement. Give back. Let's unite the world for good. We are Lions. You can be too. Visit weserve.org.
Okay, men, this is your time. Maybe you didn't choose this, but you're here now. You're going to go out there and be an all-star caregiver. Cook, clean, be there emotionally and physically. You got to dig deeper. Drive them to physical therapy, doctor's appointments, because that's what caregivers do. Don't give up. Show the world that you're tougher than tough. Caregiving is tougher than tough. Find the care guides you need at aarp.org/caregiving. Brought to you by AARP and the Ad Council.
Hi, my name's Maggie. I'm from Copaig, and I support Kingston Community Radio, and so should you.
You're with us here at KCR, Kingston Community Radio, AM 920, 92.5 FM, and streaming online at mykcr.org. 331-9255 is our call-in number. And this upcoming portion of Kingston Community Radio is brought to you by Ulster Savings Bank. Many locations throughout the Mid-Hudson Valley, one near you. It's Monday, February 22nd, 25 degrees here at 8:33 a.m. Time to get back to the on-air studio. Welcome back.
All right, thanks, Dan. We're back on, folks. And you're listening to KCR. This is Tony Marmo.
And Fran Depetrillo Savoca. And...
and Amberly Jane Campbell. Hello.
You have a lot of names.
Well, and my roller derby name is Jane Bondage.
Okay.
There you go.
So, Hudson, what?
The Mid-Hudson Misfits is our team. Yeah, but so, I played for a decade roller derby.
Okay.
What? Seriously?
Yes, absolutely.
You got to be kidding me.
I haven't hit my friends for a year almost, and it's very taxing.
No, so tell us about that. I mean, I know you're here to talk about Hudson Wire, but
yeah. No problem.
About roller derby.
I know. Sarah,
talk about a throwback sport. Come on. This is perfect.
It's a great time. I mean, I started 10 years ago in Florida. I was taking care of my mom. She was terminally ill. And it was a way to, like, you know, be okay with life and things. And I just never could give it up. I say roller derby saved my life, and it really did because of that reason. I came up here when, you know, my husband and I had our child. We moved back. And so I joined the Mid-Hudson Misfits, and I never looked back. And it's the most beautiful team. Yeah.
So
yeah,
where did they...
So we skate and bout out of Skate Time 209 in Accord.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Lynn Bernardo's place and Terry Bernardo's place.
Right, well, they sold it.
Yeah,
they sold it. And it's now going to be Neighborhood 209, I think. But during COVID summer, we skated outside, distanced, with masks, not, you know, no contact. So, yeah, no, I haven't hit my friends in almost a year.
Gosh.
Yeah.
I'm flabbergasted over this. I know yeah. You're here to talk about...
the Kingston Wire. Yeah, it's all good,
But, I don't know. Dan, do you know anybody who's been in roller derby?
One
person?
And I can't forget Jim Croce's song, Roller Derby Queen.
Yes.
You know that song,
I'm
sure.
We do play that ahead of bouts sometimes.
Yes. Great song.
Yeah.
Interesting. All right. So we'll talk about that because I want to talk about roller derby for the next half hour.
It's fascinating to me.
So tell us about Kingston Wire.
Thank you.
How it started give us a little background.
So, so we launched Kingston Wire the end of last September. So it's fairly new still. And the response has been amazing, really incredible response. We really started it because we felt like there was so much happening in Kingston and so many people were moving here from the city and elsewhere, and it really needed like additional coverage. And so there was also these amazing journalists, Dan Barton and Jesse Smith, who had recently been furloughed from the Kingston Times.
Right.
And
Jesse worked for the Freeman too, didn't he?
Yes. Yep.
And did Dan too?
Yep.
Do newspapers?
They've been with almost every newspaper around. Yeah.
Sure.
Incredibly talented individuals.
Yeah, yeah.
I love them. They're so wonderful and just good human beings.
Yeah.
And they've been covering Kingston 40 plus years between them.
Sure.
They know Kingston. We couldn't let that kind of expertise go to waste. And so all these kind of strands kind of came together and we were able to launch. It's a digital only publication. Mm-hmm. So it's KingstonWire.com. It is a subscription based publication. So when you first sign on, if you enter your name and email, you're given 4 free articles. And after that, if you want to continue reading, you can either subscribe for $5 a month or $55 a year, or you can just put a little money in your account, like 10 bucks or something, and buy articles piecemeal for 25 cents a piece.
Hmm. Yeah.
And so, yeah, I mean, you know, it's interesting because, of course, some people are like, oh, you know, why do I have to pay for this? We're all used to going on the internet, clicking on something and having it pop up, you know? But really, there's so much work behind it, and there, you know, independent journalism really needs the help of the community, you know, to keep it sustained. So,
sure.
And we are seeing a really incredible response, like I said. So,
I mean, $5 a month is pretty cheap.
Yeah, 25 cents an article. Yeah.
And it's unlimited reading. We come out with a couple new articles every single day. Mm-hmm. So we're constantly churning them out. You know, we're extremely accessible. We definitely want people from the community to contact us, you know, with their story ideas, op-eds, letters. You know, we have some kids' cartoons in there, just everything Kingston-based. Mm-hmm.
And if people see links to this or an email come in with, like, the title to click into the article, is it going to say News Atomic? Is that, like, who the email is going to be? Or?
So it says Kingston Wire kind of dot News Atomic. Okay. So News Atomic is the overarching platform that we did create and built in-house from scratch.
Okay.
So it is... I'm also the publisher of the Shuangunk Journal newspaper, which is out of Ellenville.
All right.
And so we built the platform News Atomic for us. Uh-huh. And so we have that same platform for Kingston Wire.
Okay. Interesting.
And the Shuangunk News is biweekly? I mean, is it every
We're
two?
Weekly.
Oh, you're weekly.
We come out every Thursday.
Okay,
yep.
Interesting.
And we serve the whole, like, Route 209 corridor from Ellenville, even Pine Bush, Wurtsboro, all the way up through Rosendale, which is where I live.
Mm-hmm. I mean, talk about another throwback issue was like reading the newspaper in your hands, Dan Gatus, in your hands, the newspaper.
You can still do it. If you're getting a Jones for it, you can still do it. Yeah, go down to Hannaford and grab your favorite paper.
Yeah, I guess so.
Or any other, you know, many places.
Yeah, but yeah. The bi-weeklies or the dailies are kind of, I don't know, are they on a decline somewhat?
Well, it's what we're finding is that journalism that is kind of sprung from the community is doing well, mm-hmm. and kind of journalism that is owned by a hedge fund or
corporate
entity.
Some conglomerate.
People kind of, they're kind of shying away from that little by little.
Like the Times or the Washington Post or, I mean, I read the New York Post online only because I like the sports section. I always do that. But, I haven't purchased a newspaper in like forever. And
well, do you have to purchase a subscription?
Some you don't.
You definitely find people who really want to hold the paper in their hands, mm-hmm. and then you know, I have to say it kind of skews with age.
Yeah.
And the younger folks do, they just want it all on their phone. They want to be able to just have the news right there. Yeah. And I get it. I get both ways, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I need my laptop only because I can't see my phone. So tell us, you know, we were talking earlier a little bit off the air in terms of collaborations with some of the other like Kingston Happenings and places like that
We love collaborating with local organizations. We do collaborate with Kingston Happenings, also with the History Alliance of Kingston, Blau Weiss Media,
and they're wonderful
folks, such good folks. And we are at the Kingston Farmers Market all summer.
Oh, no kidding.
So we have a table, and we love meeting people that way. I mean, it's been really difficult for an extrovert in the pandemic, you know.
But, yeah, right.
But the Farmers Market is amazing, and so we'll be doing that starting in May.
Right, great. That's really interesting. You know, I was thinking... You said you were from Highland originally, and that community is changing, like most of the communities in Ulster County, with influx of New York City or Brooklyn folks.
Oh,
and
sure.
You know, how are you reading that, and how are the folks at Kingston Wire reading that change in demographic?
Yeah, that was actually one of the things that really made us stop and say there needs to be another news outlet in Kingston, because Kingston, the 12401 area zip code, had the most amount of influx from the city of anywhere in the whole country.
Wow.
More people moved to Kingston during the pandemic than anywhere in the whole country.
Yeah, that's amazing.
So, yeah, I mean, we really have, and so, of course, that there's the topic of gentrification that people are, you know, concerned about, and so that kind of exacerbates that a little bit.
Right.
But these folks coming up from the city, they love us, and they've really, like, taken quite a liking to us. Yeah, because and they realize that for quality news, you have to pay for it. Mm-hmm. You know.
But you know, how many people are really born in Brooklyn? I mean, they moved to Brooklyn.
Right.
I guess there's, but I think, you know, like my son. Michael, who, you know, was grew up in Highland after college, you know, worked in Boston, but then worked in the city, had an apartment in New York City, couldn't afford it, then moved to Brooklyn and couldn't afford it. But by that time he was making a pretty good buck and lived in Carroll Gardens and Court Street. But, you know, a lot of the people there were from other parts, you know, of the world and country and maybe the upstate area. But so, yeah, I mean, you could put a group of Highland kids together that moved down to Brooklyn, you know, not too far from where he was. And so that they would do that. They'd hang out in all the, you know, bars and restaurants down there. But so now those folks are saying, you know what, maybe time to return to the Hudson Valley.
Yeah.
He wound up on Long Island.
Oh.
Which is great, but it's a big parking lot, you know, when you try to get on or off it. It's just...
I went to university at Stony Brook.
Oh, so you know then.
Yeah, that was my first time on Long Island, was going to college. And, I mean, I had an amazing 4 years, of course.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, but you didn't stay.
No, I mean, do people stay on the island?
Yeah, I know. I mean, his wife is from there, and that's basically why he's there. And I think, you know, it's like instant babysitter for her parents that live, you know, hop, skip, jump away from them. But I think if he had his druthers, because they were thinking about Beacon, you know, they were thinking about moving to Beacon, which is another hot spot.
I mean,
it's like, talk about Court Street. The main street in Beacon looks like, you know, the Brooklyn. And I grew up in Fishkill and remember when Beacon was like, meh.
Like nobody went to Beacon.
You know? Right. Yeah, right. Nobody went to Beacon.
Now
God bless Beacon.
It's a hot spot.
Oh,
for
to
sure.
See how it's changed in my lifetime is incredible. I mean, Uptown Kingston. I can't, you know, when I actually traveled around. I lived in Australia for a while, New Zealand and whatnot. And then when I came back, so I was away for a little while, I could not believe the difference was just, you know, amazing. I mean, it had been built up so much, so many new businesses. And anyway, it was really like alarming in a way, like, wow, this is not what I remember. But things change, of course. No, in a good way. Yeah.
A lot of folks just, you know, walk in the streets still on the weekend, even with the pandemic. And, you know, it's funny because my son and his wife's daughter-in-law's sister and husband came up from Long Island again, and they took an Airbnb down by the Strand. This was like 2 months ago. I mean, it's just like recently. And I said, you could have stayed at our house. Yeah, no, we're not doing that. We wanted to go to an Airbnb, and they hung out down at, you know, the restaurants and some of the bars, and because nothing was open in the city, so they came up here and did some outside stuff and rail trail stuff, and
we have it all.
You know, yeah. So
we do. I mean, it's so, you can't beat the environment that we have. I mean, it's just so gorgeous.
Yeah.
I there is so many things to do and even outdoor skating to do. I don't, you know,
right.
I'm always looking for that.
Outdoor.
<You know?
laughs> Let's just get back to that. 'Cause I'm, you know, obviously intrigued by the whole roller derby thing. How did you even think about getting into that? Were you a skater?
You know, I was living in Australia, and I was like, oh, you know, maybe I should join the derby team and everything. But then, you know, my mom got sick and I had to come back, and I moved to Florida to take care of her. And I was just looking to buy roller skates, you know, so I went to a rink to buy the roller skates, and the owner was like, you know what, you should join roller derby. And I did, and of course, and I never looked back. And it was, you know, I still have these amazing friends that I made, you know, 10 years ago when I first started. And it's really, the camaraderie is beautiful. You feel like a
family,
superhero.
Like family.
You know, yeah, they are, absolutely. And being on skates and hitting people, it's the closest, you know, I've ever felt to being a superhero.
Is it like real, or is it like fake, like wrestling?
Oh, it's real all the way.
It's
no,
real all the way?
It's a legit sport. Absolutely.
Yeah. I'm always fascinated by it, but I am extremely accident prone. That would be the last thing I should ever consider doing. Never, never.
Well, you know, we have a quite an age range. One of our best skaters is over 50. And she's incredible, Sandstorm.
Yeah.
So and it's like
so everybody
also,
gets a name. Storm. You get a name.
That's
you
right.
Get a name. And what was yours again?
Jane Bondage, which is also my Facebook name. So
how do you beat
that?
That's
why I'm on Facebook. Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you. Do you skate in Kingston somewhere? Because I think that'd be great to watch. You know, if there's that'd be cool. I'd go and watch.
Anywhere there's a flat parking lot or a newly paved trail. That's the ticket.
Why do I remember, like, when I, you know, was on a million years ago before the internet, I think, was invented? It was like a banked track.
Yes. That's so cool. I think the closest bank track is in New Jersey.
Okay. Yeah. That was a big deal.
It is,
and
yeah.
Whipping people. And I mean, right? There was some kind of whip thing that
you
did?
Yeah, we whip people left and right. Absolutely. No clotheslining or anything.
This is the best.
Like
you might be the best guest I've ever had. We've ever had. So I'm on Kingston Wire.
Yes. I see Kingston Wire is a member of the Ulster County Regional Chamber of Commerce.
Oh, yes, we are. Yep, absolutely.
Fran used to work there, and I was on the board for 100 years. But, you know, it's all topical information. You know, commuters beware, Broadway sewer project starts Monday morning. Is that like today?
I think it is today. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, they have news every day.
So Broadway's going to be even further screwed up.
I will not take that way back home.
The Stockade soccer folks won't fold, right? Chairman promises, but will the side take the pitch in 2021? Cool stuff, right? Mm-hmm. School resource officers to stay. So this is kind of like a nice, you know, mixture of what's going on in the community. You have a letter, op-ed section, or letter to the editor section.
Yeah, we have it's straight news and it's opinion. It's just a little bit of everything. Absolutely.
Great. So that's what is it? It's KingstonWireNewsAtomic.com.
If you just go to KingstonWire.com, you'll get right to it.
Yeah, that's what I did. Interesting. And the subscription is either $5 a month.
Yep, or $55 for the year, or you can put a little money in your account and buy articles one at a time.
Interesting. All
right. So then you're just buying the articles you want to read.
Yeah, that's it.
And, something for everybody.
When you sign up, I thank you for saying that. We try to have something for everybody, absolutely. And when you do sign up with your name and email, you'll receive a weekly e-blast of the top stories. So you'll get this nice email that people love this email. They consider it the newspaper themselves. And it has everything new from that week in the email.
Somehow I think I get that.
Oh, great.
That's why I recognize the News Atomic. I was like, because I've always kind of wondered. And I'm looking at your advertisers that pop up.
We have advertising opportunities in both the e-blast and on the platform. And, we're looking to obviously increase those. So if you, I'm always available, Amberly@KingstonWire.com. You can email info@KingstonWire.com or Dan is the editor, Dan@KingstonWire.com.
Great. So yeah, this is Amberly Jane.
Jane Campbell.
Got it.
From Kingston Wire.
Kingston Wire, you're listening to. And, plus, she's a roller derby expert.
Yeah, Jane Bondage. You'll find her on Facebook that way.
Yeah, good,
and
good news.
Yes, there's just a lot going on in Amberly's world.
Yes, that's really good. And you're living these days in Rosendale?
Right, so I own a home in Rosendale, and I am also on the Rosendale Economic Development Commission and with a great bunch of folks there. And we're also at the Rosendale Farmers Market in the summer. My weekends in the summertime are so booked, you know.
Yeah, sure.
But it's so wonderful because it's the best way to meet the community.
Yeah, absolutely.
Especially in the age of COVID.
Yeah, and Rosendale is a great community. They have their own character, their own little culture down there. It's
definitely.
Ulster County is so cool like that. You know, Saugerties is like its own place, and New Paltz its own place, and Rosendale its own. It's really great.
We have a lot of character. We really
do.
And I didn't know that the Blue Devil Dairy Bar and Grill existed on Main Street in Ellenville. I find these things interesting.
Oh yeah, that's it's a brand new.
It's one of their advertisers, if I had asked you where the Blue Devil Dairy Bar and Grill was,
I knew that the Ellenville High School mascot is a Blue Devil. Yep. I might have guessed.
So you might have guessed Ellenville.
Guessed that.
All right. Well,
good trivia question.
Yeah, it is a good trivia question. Right.
It looks
like
they're open 7 days a week.
They are. Wow. 6:30 to 7 p.m., I think.
Yeah, this is amazing, right?
Because the memory serves, right?
I'm sorry, the menu looks really good. See?
Go. Right on.
Roller derby's not my speed. Food's my speed.
I meet a friend in Ellenville who lives in Liberty, so it's kind of a midway point for us, and we go to some of the restaurants there and, you know, just have a little gathering talk, and it's great. I mean, Ellenville, I think, on the comeback. Feels like it's, you know, starting to generate despite
the
pandemic.
There's also, in Ellenville, there's like the old Terrace Motel on the Hill that's very dilapidated. Someone just bought that, someone from the city.
Oh, no kidding.
So they have all these grand plans for it. And so it really is on an upswing. I believe in Ellenville.
Yeah,
you know?
That's great. The Nevely, they were starting a project there, making it some kind of a sports academy. Did that ever happen?
No, yeah.
That failed?
No, unfortunately, the funding didn't come through for that project.
Bad.
Yeah, and so it's going to, I mean, it might have to be like a tear-down situation.
Yeah. You know, well, but at this point. Yeah. Did the pandemic catch that? Is that what happened? That got tied
no,
up?
No, or, it was
just
pre...
just a pure funding issue?
Yeah, unfortunately.
Yeah, no, that's... but there's so many things happening, I think, in Ulster County. Little bit. I mean, I grew up in Dutchess County, so that's got its own distinct, you know, flavor and what happens there. But I think Ulster County is just cool, the place to be, and
we have it
so
all.
Much to offer.
Yeah,
right?
We have everything here. That's why everybody's coming up.
Yeah, right. It's true. Yeah, I mean, that side of the river does have the passenger train, though. That's you know.
But,
and if you had to do it all over again, we had this question earlier, you know, would you live with the internet or without the internet? Would you live with cell phones, without cell phones? Would you swap the thruway for the passenger train?
No.
You would not?
No.
Why not?
Because, I mean, you can still get here from there, Tony, even though the train stops on their side. You could take the walkway over, you could take your bicycle, you could walk, you can have somebody pick you up. So we're good.
But that would be an interesting little discussion saying, you know, if you had it to do all over again, New York State, and they made a deal, you know, Dewey made a deal with somebody.
So when you think about it, the train, you're already in like public transportation mode. So you can easily get here from there because you're already in public transportation mode. The thruway, do you realize how lucky we are that you can just get in your car and hop on the thruway? Like when you're somewhere else and you're like, oh, if I want to take the thruway, I've got to drive to here to get to there to get on the thruway. Hello.
Yeah, the convenience.
Amberly, if you had a choice, I know what Fran's vote is. If you had a choice today, thruway or passenger train to Manhattan and Albany, up wherever, what would you pick? From an economic development standpoint, what would you pick?
Right. I suppose that's true. Can I say the light rail? No.
I don't think that was invented yet.
No. I think we're pretty good. We've got very convenience factors.
We have the best of both worlds.
Yes, and we're so close to so many farms. I mean, the fresh food. I mean, you know, talk about fresh food.
Yeah.
Like, we're just so lucky to be in this like beautiful pocket.
Yeah.
And with the thruway running through our county,
right?
You can stop off all the way up from Marlboro, Milton, Highland, all the way.
If you got on the train at Poughkeepsie, you could get off in Cold Spring and buzz around Cold Spring, get back on the train, go down to Peekskill, come back up.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think I probably would pick, I would pick the thruway too. I mean, I think as an individual, it's
easier. I'm glad to hear it.
Yeah. And those people that made zillions of dollars with the Rosendale cement on the thruway were probably happy that the thruway got put on this side. The Snyder family made gazillions. And, it's interesting. Today is a perspective about looking back and saying, if this didn't happen, what would the world be like? Mm-hmm. You know, which is a little bit interesting to have that dialogue and think about, you know, no internet, no cell phone, mm-hmm. no throughway in the side of the river, what would happen?
I'm definitely glad that I grew up without cell phones.
Yes.
And without just the internet, you
yeah.
know,
yeah.
just invading everyone's life and everything. I'm
yeah.
so glad.
But your generation, you know, kind of started with electronic games for the kids, right? Sega, I know,
oh,
you know.
The Game Boy and everything.
The Game Boy,
yeah,
all that
sure.
stuff started around the 90s,
yep.
You know, when you were kind of sort of graduating high school in that neck of the woods. I don't want to age you, but we were
no,
talking
it's,
about
it's fine.
There.
It's fine.
But yeah, so it's interesting now the kids, you know, 4-year-old grandson picks up the phone and knows what to do with it, you know? Mm-hmm.
Yes, we were Scary. Watching The Simpsons and my 7-year-old daughter was like, why do they have to put a quarter in a phone? Why do they have to find a phone and
yeah,
put a quarter
yeah.
in it? She did not yeah. understand that at yeah. all. It was so, you know, that's what happens. You just
All right, we have to break. Thank you so much for coming in. Amber Jane.
We're
going to
have
Amber
you
Lee,
back on.
Amber Lee Jane
oh, thank
Campbell.
Thank you so much.
And Fran, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, it was great. It was fun, as usual.
See you
I'm
going to
go
month.
Take a nap now, I think.
Oh, me too. Oh, me too.
Dan Gatiss, thank you very much.
Bye, Dan. Thank you.
All the best. Everyone be safe. Be well.
Thank
Peace
you so much.
And love.
Okay. Yeah, you woke me up from a nap, Tony. Okay, and thank you for being with us today. This is... thank you for being with us on Kingston Community Radio. It's Monday, February 22nd, about 25 degrees still here in Uptown Kingston. And this last portion of Kingston Community Radio was brought to you by Ulster Savings Bank. Many locations throughout the Mid-Hudson Valley, locations near you. And again, thank you so much for being with us and listening to KCR, Kingston Community Radio, AM 920, 92.5 FM and streaming online at mykcr.org. And thank you, Tony Marmo and Fran Depetrillo Savoca, for bringing us around today. And thank you, Lorraine Salmon, also a co-host who called in, and David Bowd, Lisa Berger, and Amber Lee, Jane Campbell. Thank you so much for being our guests today. And until tomorrow at 7 a.m., we wish you every success in growing and developing Kingston and all our neighboring communities. This last portion of Kingston Community Radio has been brought to you by Ulster Savings Bank. Many locations throughout the Mid-Hudson Valley, locations near you. Now we return you to Real Country Radio. Don't let it fool you about what's inside. There might be a little dust on the fire. Real Country. WBNR Beacon, WLNA Peekskill, WGHQ Kingston, and online at realcountryhv.com. We're country to the core. Real country. I'm a hard-working man. I wear